First things first, game five in Sunrise. Someone's going to go up 3-2. Nielsen, quick shot. Luongo leaves a rebound. Hickey's got it. Shoots. Save. Rebound. Score. To the spot. And save. Grice. And a save by Grice. Grice again.
Thomas Grice is Johnny on the spot.
Hendrick scores. This game is going to keep on going. How about this? A penalty shot in overtime. Denied. Now Twine fires. He scores. Alan Quine. Welcome to Stanley Cup Playoff Lore.
Tonight is the night. Or at least all of Isles Nation sure hopes so. It's game six between the Isles and the Panthers. New York leads the series 3-2 after a thrilling double overtime win in Sunrise a few nights ago. New York Islanders hockey is presented by Geico. This series has produced some unlikely heroes, but hey, when it comes to the Stanley Cup playoffs, anything can happen. Alan Quine was playing in the AHL just a few short weeks ago. He's coming off the biggest game and the biggest goal of his life. Who will step up tonight? Stay with us as the quest for the cup continues. Hello, everyone. Welcome inside Barclays Center for game six between the Islanders and the Panthers. I'm Shannon Hogan. Well, this will be the 50th Islanders playoff game since the last time that they won a playoff series. It was 23 years ago, 1993, and I know that the Islanders, the coaching staff, and the fans would all like to snap that streak tonight. It's going to take every extra bit of energy they have to take down the Panthers, and they're going to need all of the support from the fans here in the building and, of course, all the fans around the country at home. For more on the big matchup, game six with the Panthers, let's go up to the booth and welcome in Howie Rose and Butch Goring.
All right, Shannon, thank you very much. And so here are the Islanders at the precipice where they haven't been in 23 years, and back then, and 23 years before that, and 23 before that, they said the toughest game to win is the fourth one. Does it still hold true?
I think it does, and not so much that you have to play so much different, Howie. It's the opposition. They know this could be the end for them. They could be out there enjoying their summer. So for the Islanders, you know, they've got to stay patient. They've got to play Islander hockey. Guys like John Tavares, Kyle Oposo, Franz Nielsen, they're all the vets of this hockey team. They've been through this rigmarole a little bit before, particularly last year. And they said to him, Matt, we need to take the next step. We need to be prepared to get to the next round. Well, they have that chance tonight.
And one of the reasons they have that chance is because their goaltending has been outstanding. And their goaltending has been simply Thomas Grice. It's been him all the way because of the injury to Yaroslav Halak. But he's needed help. And the Islanders preach offense from their defense. And Grice has had some help with huge goals in this series from defensemen.
And the defense are going to have to continue to play well. First and foremost, they've got to take care of their own zone. They've got to be physical. They've got to block shots. They've got to make sure they're positionally there. Play with some desperation. Slide down, block shots any way you possibly can. Finish your checks. They do that, Howie. Then comes the offense, and they got to be prepared to continue to jump up. Thomas Hickey with the overtime goal. Johnny Boychuk's got to jump up. Letty's got to carry that puck. All those things have to happen if you want to take the next step.
Well, the Islanders don't have a lot of guys. Of course, last year was different. It was a seventh game, so you could almost throw that out. Boychuk knows what it's like to lead a series and close it out. Only Nick Leddy can say that with Boychuk on the Islanders. And this kid made a good return to action in game number five, and they need Vincent Trocheck tonight because Nick Bjugstad, with an upper body injury, is going to miss this game. So for the Islanders, it's an opportunity to seal the deal right here, right now. Save themselves a trip to Florida, at least one part of the state. They'd love to go to the other. They can firm that up next.
And the home of the brave.
Fantastic job by Amanda Kolecki here at Barclays Center, and the fans are ready for this one. Howie and Butch, take it away.
All right, Shannon, thank you. And Butch, you've been in this situation as a player before. From the Islanders, what do you expect at the outset? Little nervousness or gangbusters?
Well, I expect a little of both, actually, Howie. I expect them to be a little nervous, but I also expect them to come out with all guns a-blazing. I mean, all this emotion, all this energy, they're ready to go, and they should be. Take this game right away from the Florida Panthers.
Well, they beat Luongo in overtime in game five. Jack Capuano trying to move on for the first time as a National Hockey League head coach. As you look at a bench that's nervous, jumpy, excited, and probably a million other adjectives that we'll learn as this game progresses, but those you see on the bench do not include Nielsen, Kuhlman, and Bailey, because they're going to start up front. DeHaan and Boychuk back. Barkov with Huberdeau and Jagr for Florida. Petrovic and Campbell the defense, and it took 6 seconds for the Islanders to ice the puck. Changing on the move. And here is Jagr, still goalless in this series and in the last 36 cup games he's played. Big collision at the far side. Jokinen and Hamonic, they are intertwined with each other. Hamonic is dragging Jokinen with him while the Islanders move into the Florida zone. They may go. They're separated, but then Trocheck comes in and throws his hip out at Hamonic. And this can get interesting right away. Now, there was no altercation per se, I don't think, that you could justify throwing Trocheck out as the third man in. However, I don't know that I've seen this one before, Butch.
Well, the referee was is being given to admonish a little bit with Travis Hamonic. As you can see, Jokinen there clearly has the stick in his hand. He's holding on to Travis. Travis was looking at the referee and saying, hey, what are you miscalling? But clearly the referees, they don't want to play a big role in this game.
The lines. And now here is Letty throwing it across to Oposo. And over the line, thought about a shot. Freezed Kulikov, gets it back, puts it off a leg, and it's pushed just wide by Prince and covered by Goodbranson. And Luongo is at the wrong side of the net when Prince released that puck. After a great start to this series. Austin there, and comes Tavares. Tavares for DeHaan. Quick shot, Luongo to save. Oposo knocked down. Wine got it loose, but Jokinen gets it back and shovels it into the center ice area.
Luongo a little bit nervous. He's propped up a couple of early rebounds. Islanders should be aware of that. Get themselves out in front of that net for any of those rebounds.
Feck and ricochet of the hit on Kulikov went into both Goodbranson and Cizikas, and Clutterbuck knocked down again.
Now the puck came up on by Logan. Logan was looking to shoot the puck in the corner, Howie, on the backhand. Puck came in and hit him in the mouth area. You can see there's blood already on the ice. He may have to go to the dressing room for some repairs.
Going right in.
Yeah, you can see there. It was a puck that came up by Logan as it was Logan Shaw trying to just shoot it into the corner.
6:01 gone, first period.
You know, all the goals in each period, it's almost the same. You can see there's the shot by, on the backhand, Logan Shaw up in the face of Clutterbuck. Blood streaming out of his mouth right away. Well, let's just hope it's a short stay, a couple of stitches, and get back out here and play. But that smarts, because you don't have any protection there. That's the chicklets area, Howie, and he may have lost one or two, or perhaps just a cut, but...
And Martin keeping pressure on Ekblad. Cizikas looks for Martin at the other side. He and Ekblad get there together. So it's Cizikas being hounded and dumped by Purcell. Play allowed to continue, and it's going to be a night when just about anything goes.
Rules have changed for this game, no doubt about it.
Up. Twist it to the far side to Oposo. While Oposo moving behind the net on his backhand. Has it blocked. Rebound! Oh, Luongo stopped it at the last second. Good play by Oposo. Kept it on his backhand. Turned to the forehand. And Luongo just did grab it.
Can't analyze that any better than that, Howie. That was tremendous. That's exactly what happened. Kyle kept his feet moving. Tried the backhander. Stayed with it. With a good battle. There was Matt Martin with his shot drilled in him wide. Boychuk had nothing else to do. Smart play. Get it in deep. And then it's Kyle Oposo. Good quick move. Keeps his feet moving. Protects the puck. Backhand stops. Doesn't just sort of skate away, stops, stays with it, and forces Luongo to make a great save.
The boards was cut off. Hamonic didn't get it ahead, though, and so here's Jagr the other way into the Islanders' zone. Matheson fires. Grice has it. Not quite sure where it is, I don't think, but he's got it. And there's no further play. Just froze, even though he had the puck in his glove. 3:58 remaining, first period.
That should be some kind of series. The hottest team in the National Hockey League against the team with the best record in the National Hockey League.
Huberdeau, wrist 20, scores! Jonathan Huberdeau was on his way down as he shot that puck. And from about 40 or 45 feet, beats Thomas Grice. And the Panthers have a 1-0 lead with a minute 2 to go in this first period.
Yeah, I'm not sure if he two things, Howie, that he may have been screened just a little bit. And I'm not sure if Thomas Grice expected it as Huberdeau was going down and really was on all fours when he shot the puck. Quick little passing play. We talked about them being tight. Watch as he goes down, and then Letty's out in front, about 15 feet in front of him, so he might not have had a good look as normal. Maybe another look at from this angle. I think that Letty screened him just enough that he didn't pick it up quick enough. A nice shot by Jonathan Huberdeau over the right shoulder into the top corner. And the Panthers have struck first at the tail end of this first period.
Panthers played a pretty good first period, yet they come away trailing 1-0. Trocheck and Jokinen picked up the assists on Huberdeau's goal. The shots on goal almost irrelevant. They're 7-5 Islanders, but the attempts and the amount of opportunities the Islanders decided to take to throw pucks towards the Florida net much higher than 7. So many were blocked by the Panthers, and others went wide. And so 1-0 Florida after one. And coming up in our Ford intermission report, Shannon will chat with Islanders defenseman Nick Letty. Rick DiPietro will be on the set, and Butchie and I will have first period highlights as well, all coming up on the Ford intermission report. So at the end of one, with the Islanders trying to advance, it's the Panthers who lead 1-0.
There'll be a lot of different line combinations now with Josh Bailey out of the lineup right now.
Here's Prince trying to get a shot off. He backhands it. It's stuffed by Luongo. Slithered loose, but by that time the whistle had blown.
Prince with another good opportunity using his speed and skill as he drives towards that net. Talk about going to the dirty areas. Again, Prince, a couple of crossovers coming out of the corner. Good forechecking job by Nelson, and there's Prince going to the middle, keeps going, pounds for the loose puck. Luongo again down low, covering the bottom part of the ice. A lesson learned from the great Patrick Waugh: take away the bottom of the ice. A high percentage play worked for him. I'm not sure why this always amazes me with faceoffs. When the defensive player is supposed to have a stick down first, he doesn't get it down. That's his problem, wouldn't you think, Howie?
Evidently, but the linesman did it again, and this time Huberdeau will bring it to center. Huberdeau with the only goal so far. Gahan off the boards, not out, hit Barkov, and now Kuhlman carries on. In over the line, feeds Cizikas, thought about a shot, now throws it. Cross Eisner ricocheted, I think, off a Panther, and then diagonally back towards the Florida goal.
Almost got a lucky one. A little fake by Cizikas, and then tried to get a cross ice pass near the crease area for deflection. Good smart play by Cizikas. Again, it's tough to beat the goaltenders when they can square up on you. There's Cizikas, a little fake, and then right off the defenseman, Petrovic, and almost caroms into the empty net because Luongo had started to go to play the cross ice pass.
Harris sends it all the way down into the Florida zone.
Both these teams are transition teams.
Chance in front for Oposo. Stop. Oposo and Kulikov tangled up. Hamonic shoots. Karam's out in front. And it's covered by Luongo. Well, the end result will be a faceoff deep in the Florida zone. Well, the Islanders with a couple of chances there.
A turnover by the Florida Panthers in their own zone, and Kyle Oposo couldn't quite find the handle as he picked it up off the boards. You know, when there's a lot of spin often, you can see the Branson just loses the puck. Kyle driving towards that. Lucky for the Panthers that Kulikov recognized the problem. There's the turnover, and Kyle trying to get to the right side, and then the collision.
And for Florida, Jablitski's glove remains behind the Islander goal. Back of the line, it's Ekblad. Wristing one, a change direction, but Grice has it.
That was a deflection, a shot by Ekblad, deflection by Huberdeau. big positional save by Thomas Greiss.
Tonight's Cold Hard Facts are brought to you by Frost Brewed Coors Light. And this is what you'd call the Something's Gotta Give series, as the Islanders and the Panthers have gone the longest of all teams in the NHL since their last playoff series win. David Bollock gave the Islanders a win in 1993, and the Panthers went all the way to the final in only their third year of existence, 1996, before being swept by the Colorado Avalanche, who had just moved that year from Quebec, where they'd been the Nordiques. Without Josh Bailey, who left with about 5 minutes remaining in the first period. Hamonic knocked down. Panthers keep the puck alive. Rochette beating down low, comes in front. Greiss with a big save on Jokinen. Huge save by Thomas Greiss. And the Panthers looking for a call in there. Riley Smith pleading his case to the referee.
Well, it was Jokinen who was in the four-man attack. That puck bounces out. That was a late hit by Clutterbuck after the shot, after the play, probably after the whistle. There's the opportunity, and then there's the swipe. I'm not sure you can give a guy a penalty afterwards, but what a big save again from Thomas Greiss. Point blank, you see Jokinen out for it if it happens again.
Well, the Panthers win the draw. Still 55 to go on Kuhlman's penalty. Ekblad, the Huberdeau, he shoots, saved by Greiss. That one got through a lot of people in front.
Not sure I saw it. That's just a guy that looks big and played big on that shot.
Kulikov put it off his own man, Jokinen. Recovered. Now to Barkov. Save made. Rebound is loose. Greiss poked it away. It's underneath. DeHaan rolls towards the goal, and Greiss has it.
Well, you want to go to the net, you're going to pay a price.
It was actually under Boychuk initially, not DeHaan, but DeHaan was in on that little scramble right at the end there, too.
Jokinen was in front, and then DeHaan knocked him down, and there's no way that you're going to be able to get a penalty call from either side.
DeHaan made the first one, eventually Boychuk another one, and then DeHaan, and still 1-0. Meantime, Nielsen in on the right wing. It's the trailer, Kuhlman. Now to DeHaan, he cuts in, he shoots, save Luongo. Rebound is loose, Nielsen shoots, Luongo the save, and Luongo covers, and the almost compulsory shoving and pushing, and nothing more develops. We haven't had an all-out fight in this game or anything like that, but so many of these goal-mouth scrambles have been punctuated by just that.
Yeah, it all starts because it was a four-man rush. Johnny Boychuk got up on the play, and that allowed Franz Nielsen to go down the wing, and then the defense backed off, and that gave Franz the opportunity to be a little patient with it. You can see him stopped. Johnny Boychuk goes to the net. DeHaan's up on the play, so that, in essence, was a five-man rush. Boychuk stopped in front. He created the distraction and a couple of good whacks. There's a hold in front there by Matheson on Prince. He gets away, or Campbell, I guess it is. Oh, I got it right the first time. It was Matheson. Oh, he gets away with one, but that's going to happen in this game. There's going to be very, very few calls, but a good rush by the Islanders.
Islanders are going to take a 1-0 lead into their room at the end of two periods, with the Panthers trying to send it home for a game seven. The Islanders trying to end it right here, but 17 shots apiece for the Islanders, not as good in the second period as they were in the first.
Now the Florida Panthers tried to extend their lead and be able to come into the third period with possibly a 2 or 3 goal lead, but certainly Thomas Greiss was resilient as usual. But again, how it's a matter of, you know, spending more time in the offensive zone and eliminating those turnovers. You got to have the patience. Chip and chase, finish your checks, force them to play in their zone and take faceoffs, and that creates a lot of offense for you.
So coming up, our second intermission report brought to you by Chevrolet. Shannon will chat with Casey Cizikas, Rick DiPietro, and we'll have highlights as well. Still 1-0 in Florida. Well, the fans are fully engaged. The Islanders, once again without Josh Bailey, left the ice with about 5 minutes to go in the first period. And so the Islanders still 11 forwards as we begin the third. Islanders trying to wrap this series up. But the Panthers have eyes on a game seven. And here's Jágr shooting up high and a save made by Crease. Petrovic comes down the boards. And that ricochets out of play, but the Panthers, in the first 15 seconds, get an opportunity for one of the all-time greats in this league, albeit now at age 44.
A tough angle shot, but an aggressive Crease takes it off the shoulder. You can see going, trying to go high, but Thomas Crease out a long ways and cuts that angle down. Now, once that puck's below the dot, Howie, if...
Boy, you could tell the urgency now in a context we haven't seen yet. Our location on the broadcast booth here is right in the crowd. Jedlicki feeds Clutterbuck, a save made by Luongo.
Well, that was a terrific opportunity and an even better save.
Jedlicki across. Clutterbuck waiting. Martin tangled up behind the net with Matheson. Cizikas and Shaw in there as well. Cizikas to Clutterbuck, a save by Luongo. And now the fans brought out of their seats. I was just starting to say that on every Islander rush now, you can see the fans in front of us begin to stand up. And that's a sight we have not seen all year, or for that matter, all playoff series until this period.
What an opportunity for Cal Clutterbuck. He had a couple of golden opportunities. The last one was the best as he take a little look. Ryan Smith, there's the shot there, just a little pass, as I said, in the slot area. But Cal Clutterbuck, there's the one-time shot. Nice save by Luongo, and he does get another one, too. And that one's even better. Cizikas spots him, and Cal Clutterbuck doesn't get it anywhere near where he wants to. He hits him in the chest, hits a corner, Howie, and that puck's in, and this game's tied. So,
and the puck taken back by Trocheck. 14-16 left in the third. Trocheck working on DeHaan. Trocheck around the net, put it in front. But Jokinen couldn't finish as Crease was scrambling. Great play by Trocheck.
Florida Panthers lead the Islanders 1-0 in the third period. Tremendous move by Trocheck. Like I said before, it doesn't look like he's moving, but he's just weaving himself through and tries a little wraparound. Gets a little, Islanders get a little help finally. And Prince with a good speed down the wing. Bernier cruising in. Can't quite get a stick on that puck's bouncing.
Now is Shaw, but he's cut off by Jedlicki. Played it to the back of Nielsen's skate, but Oposo alertly follows ahead. Quick shot, clutch save made by Luongo. And a faceoff coming in the Florida zone. Jágr, who had gone to the Florida room for some sort of repair, has come back.
You talk about getting your feet moving. Kyle Oposo creates that opportunity to get the shot away. Never stopped skating, even though the Panthers were on his tail. And
both of them.
Absolutely.
Wilson in the corner.
Oh, and there's a big hit by Boychuk on Wilson as he caught him. Remember, the Plagers used to do that, catch you on the opposite side of the net, Howie. Johnny Boychuk. Wilson's got his head down, and Boychuk comes from the opposite side, so Wilson doesn't see him come. And that's just a good solid check. Wilson loses his stick, but as I mentioned, the Plager brothers from St. Louis used to do that all the time.
Comes ahead with Oposo. Tavares making a move towards the slot. Now curls back, protects the puck, feeds Boychuk. Big drive save, Luongo. It's loose. Mackenzie ever so gently appeared to nudge that puck into Luongo. While everybody else wrestles, Luongo just releases the puck.
And you see the position Luongo had. He was able to get to the top of that paint and make him save.
8:40 remaining in the third. Still 1-0 Florida. Tin Cup Mountain Whiskey, keys to the game, brought to you by Tin Cup Whiskey. Who knew? Up here, it's just man in the mountain and his tin cup. Tin Cup Whiskey, Mountain Whiskey. Well, the key to the game for the Islanders, score a goal and take it from there, because they're down one and have been since late in the first period. But they had more thrust, they had more attempts, they had more opportunities in the first than they've had since. But Huberdeau's goal stands. The zone with 7.5 to go in the third. Jedlicki's got away. Cizikas was trapped in the zone. Meantime, Jedlicki was hit by Mackenzie, and here's Huberdeau shooting, and that's gloved and held by Thomas Crease. There may be a penalty being called here, and I think there is. And the Panthers are getting it, and Huberdeau is furious. And the Islanders going to get a power play with 7:23 remaining in the third.
Now that's a big break. Huberdeau's not happy about it. But I said at some point in time, Howie, you're going to get called for initiating a late hit afterwards or a punch. We'll get another look at what Huberdeau did, but I'm sure that's what it is. It's, you're coming in, you're getting in a pushing and a shoving. That's one thing. And take a little look, take a watch. So Huberdeau comes in. There's Hickey in front, and there's the high stick, and that's an easy call. I mean, you got to call that one. You can let him away with the pushing and the shoving.
Waits, took a little bump along the way, but finds a Poso. Across now to Letty. Tavares with Nelson Park in front. Tavares shoots, save, made. Rebound, Nelson, save, Luongo. It's loose. Tavares can't reach it. Now he recovers. Trying to get it loose, he does, to Kuhlman. Power play about to expire. Here comes Huberdeau. Team's at full strength. Shidlitsky's shot blocked. Shidlitsky again feeds Kuhlman. A sprawling save by Luongo.
Oh, a tremendous save by Luongo. He had the waffle down low and it hit it.
Now Kuhlman to Shidlitsky. Draws Huberdeau down. Put it out in front. Batted away and out of the zone.
A furious attack by the Islanders. Luongo has been super. His best save of the game just came up a little while ago. Well, sometimes you have to have your blocker in the right position. Watch Luongo's head. Look left, had his blocker down on the right side, shot by Kuhlman. So that's what you call a positional save, Howie. Luongo didn't see the puck. He looked left, the puck came right, but his blocker was in the perfect spot, and you make the save.
Cizikas has the puck. He's bumped by Ekblad. Nudge back to the line to Hahn's shot. Change direction. Kuhlman put it off the stick of Luongo, who alertly clamps down on it. Kuhlman actually backhanded that, I think, for that exact purpose. With Luongo moving, he tried to deflect it or ricochet it off of the goaltender, and he almost pulled it off.
Yeah, you want to, you know, desperation. Get it out in front, and Luongo's got the paddle down on the ice, taking away that short side. You can see the paddle down, making sure that he doesn't give anything away down low.
First chip in attempt succeeds with his second. 1:47 remaining in the third. You can expect to see Grice head to the bench, and here he goes as the Islanders move ahead. The Islander bench, the Islander net is empty. They have an extra skater on. It's Martin who jumps on. Then he gets tripped up, collides with his own man, Nielsen. They both took a spill, and the puck somehow stays in the Florida zone. But now Kulikov has space. A minute 24 remain in the third. Empty net, it rolls wide of that goal. Letty and Smith tussle in the corner. Letty up the boards. Kept alive for Florida by Trocheck. He takes it back. Trocheck with the empty net, drops it back. Shot from the blue line, blocked, rebound, slithers wide.
Now Letty can get going.
A minute 5 left in the third. Empty net for the Islanders. They have an extra skater. Letty down the boards. Letty one-hands it in front. Missed. Rebound backhanded. And
they score.
Rebound star. Tavares. John Tavares on the third or fourth Islander attempt has tied it with 53.2 seconds remaining in the third period.
And it all starts, Howie, with the play down low. Nick Letty carried it 200 feet and was able to get it in front. Watch Letty weaving his way down, and then he turns the jets on once he can get to the outside and does the smart thing. Just throws it in front. The Islanders all go to the net, and Tavares drives in the loose puck. Luongo's not able to handle that rebound, and it's in the net, and it's 1-1. Watch Luongo makes the initial save, and then the puck comes loose, and Tavares taps it in. Watch the bench's reaction. But what a play by Letty, and what a craziness in front of the net in Islander and Howie when the Panthers had a chance to maybe salt it away.
And so, after actually going pointless in the last game, Tavares gets one of the biggest goals of his career, if not the biggest, because it does give the Islanders now an opportunity to finish this thing off either in the next 53.2 or in overtime.
Well, I think right now, if you're the Islanders, you take a deep breath and you thank your lucky stars you tied it up, and you're getting into overtime where you can catch your breath and regroup, Howie.
And what a rush by Nick Leddy to start it off.
Oh, it was unbelievable.
Barkov to Huberdeau. He's just got to throw it at the net. He does. It's turned aside by Grice. Game six goes to overtime. And the Islanders now are one shot away from advancing. But it's Tavares with his fourth from Kuhlman and Leddy at 19:06. The shots 32-30 through regulation time. And if you've been paying attention to this series, I'd stick around for quite a while, perhaps. It may take quite a while.
That's just an unbelievable finish for the Islanders. They kept pushing and pushing. And Howie, it's just been a fabulous game. I mean, everybody's had opportunities, and the goaltending's been nothing short of sensational. I mean, Luongo made a couple of huge saves late in that period. And then finally, the Islanders, with the aid of Leddy with a 200-foot rush.
Well,
more excitement.
Butchie and I are going to save our voices for a while. We may need them for hours to come. You'll be entertained by Shannon, Rick, and more. 1-1 headed to overtime. New York Islanders Overtime Report is presented to you by New York Life Insurance Company. Keep good going. And can the Islanders keep their string of overtime success going? They've already won two games in this series in overtime. First, it was Thomas Hickey. So he'd be a relatively unlikely candidate if you were to handicap this, right? Who'd be less likely than the guy who won the game two nights ago? Alan Quine. That's why I get such a kick out of him. Let's analyze what's going to happen in overtime. Who the heck knows? The goofiest things can win overtime games and have in the past, but one thing that's been pretty well constant is that since they played their first overtime in 1975, overtime has been Islander time. You saw the graphic earlier when Rick was chatting with Shannon. If you're an Islander fan, you didn't need to see it, you know it. No team in the history of the National Hockey League has a better percentage than the New York Islanders do in overtime. Shot off the end boards. Oposo looks for it. Petrovic around. Not out. He ran into Leddy, and the puck stays deep. Oposo wheeling. Tavares to Leddy. Throws it in front off Oposo's stick.
Well, that was deflected. That was almost a fortuitous break for the Islanders as Leddy threw that.
It's it ahead. Branson's got it. Picked off by Cizikas. They see it over the line. Cizikas driving to the net. Cizikas put it in front. Quick shot by Clutterbuck. Stopped by Luongo.
I'm not sure if it even got to the net, Howie. There's a bunch of guys in front of the net. What an opportunity by Clutterbuck. There was a bunch of legs in front. He tried to snap it right away, but I believe that hit Gabranson, who was in front of the net. See the Purcell picking up the loose puck
behind the Islander goal.
Really quick changes for the Florida Panthers. They're 20 seconds, Howie, and they're getting up.
Oposo looking for Tavares. Backhander up high. It might have gotten Luongo in the mask.
Might have caught the crossbar also.
Tavares put it out in front. Luongo gets a piece of it as Oposo got the shot.
John Tavares on the backhand. Couldn't get a lot on it. You can see he's reaching for the puck, just gets it towards the net, lifts it high off the mask of Luongo, a little bit more of his left, and that one may have gone in. And there's Kyle Oposo with a good opportunity. I believe he missed the net, though, Howie, as Luongo had the short side. The two close opportunities and a great shot by Tavares. That was very eerily close to going in.
Matheson, Nielsen was not in a position to challenge. He had to get to the bench. Oh, here comes Shaw into the Islander zone. Logan Shaw, a one-hander, is stopped by Grice. And another face-off coming in the Islander zone. Nice rush by Shaw.
And that's what I said about changes. You have to be so careful. It's a long change. You're going to the bench. The Panthers are going to have an opportunity to jump up through the neutral zone unimpeded. There's Matheson, who has good speed, tries to fool Thomas Greiss to thinking he's going to wrap it all the way around and get him to move, but Greiss just wasn't buying on that particular play.
Now Oposo brings it in to Tavares. A knockdown by Kulikov. Tavares keeps working. Tavares brings it right to the line, throws it through traffic right to Luongo.
Well, Oposo was in front, but he left the front of the net thinking Tavares was going to whip it in behind the net, so he wanted to try and get position. Tavares fooled everybody except for Luongo. He tracked it all the way.
Well, he had to do to get that shot off, and he put it right to the crest of Luongo.
He really did.
Impressive.
I mean, look at the determination on John Tavares. He's watching everybody come around, and then everybody thinks he's just going to wrap it in behind the net, including Kyle Oposo.
Yeah. How would I know that? Barkov behind the net. Barkov in the corner. With the blue line to Kulikov. And Barkov, a long drive, blocked away by Greiss. Good save by Greiss. Huberto gets it back. Barkov across. Shot blocked. Purcell got one. The company. Purcell for Florida. Trying to get away from the pressure applied by Zydlitsky and Tavares. Panthers get it back. Barkov put it in front. DeBranson missed up high as Oposo and Zydlitsky went down, forcing the shot to go way upstairs. And Hickey just wants to get rid of it. He gave it away to Purcell.
That was outside.
Comes out.
Yeah, that was outside. Just barely outside. Linesman right on the line. Again, Islanders a little bit of a panic mode there. Howie needed to get their feet moving again.
Time for a breather. They'll scrape the ice. 9:42 to go. First overtime. Well, a little more than halfway through the first overtime period. The Islanders had some chances early. The Panthers have had a few more recently.
Well, just that last shift, there was chaos. Everybody was diving and trying to get in front of the puck and the possible shots. There was a lot of blocking, jumping over goaltenders, and some pretty good opportunities. As I mentioned, Howie, you know, a little panic. You gotta maintain your cool, react to the shots. Don't be in such a rush just to give up the puck. There's the opportunity towards the net. Look at the desperation on the Islanders as Zydlitsky dives over Thomas Greiss.
Tavares plays it in. Luongo looks to see who's around to help. Ultimately, it was Huberdeau, but Tavares gets it back. Tavares put it right through the crease. Now it's Hickey. Well, the organ has got the message. Listen.
Yeah, he really did. Florida a little slow on their changes as far as I was concerned.
Paul Archer, the best in the business. He got right on the pressure idea. And now Goodbranson goes across to Ekblad. Checked by Prince, turns it over. Nelson's drive up high, a save made. Rebound loose, little dribbler by Prince went wide. Maybe Luongo got a piece. And Jokinen with a cross ice feed. And now Nelson with Prince. Nelson closing in. He shoots. Luongo the save. And there'll be a face-off in the Florida zone.
That was a good opportunity. The first odd man rush for the Isles. Brock Nelson elects to shoot. Never a bad play, but it wasn't much of an angle. He was inside the dots. Prince was with him. Florida Panther got caught up the ice on the turnover. Brock Nelson, there's the first one. Little slaps out there, was a bit of a rebound, and Prince had the rebound, couldn't put it in. And this is the best chance for Brock Nelson. He's looking, but he sees Trocheck has no angle to be able to get it across. And Luongo comes up with a big save, holds his position, holds his angle, and Brock Nelson had nowhere else to go with it. Because they're going to bed, because they're just going to be drained, exhausted from watching playoff hockey. It just doesn't get any better than that. And we talk about excitement.
Here's Bernier now down the wing. Fires off of Luongo.
Oh, that Darnar almost snuck by. And what an unlikely hero Steve Bernier would be.
Where it started into that corner. And now Jágr goes to work. Jágr to Huberdeau. Put it out in front. Jágr chipped out. It saved Greiss, and he's got the rebound.
And the Florida Panthers, Barkov line again, worries their magic in tight with the good support and the strong puck protection. Jágr, nobody's ever been better at protecting the puck. Steve Bernier has a beautiful up pass, lets the shot go, and that just dribbles through the arms of Luongo, and then the other end, and anxious moments as the puck heads towards the net, but again, Thomas Greiss is able to smother it. Nervous moments for both benches as they watch both the teammates at either end of the building have to go to work.
Boy, you talk about ice time for Gabranson's got to be just inundated with a whole bunch of ice time. I mean, they've been using him.
Remember that
29 plus minutes, so he's playing an awful lot out there, and there are hard minutes too. He's playing a physical game, so that takes his toll on you. Strength on the puck. John Tavares.
Second and third effort to score a goal.
Hickey up ahead. Here comes Quine. He's in. He shoots off the glove of Luongo.
Well, there was the clear two-on-one chance.
Here's McKenzie shooting, and a blocker save made by Greiss.
There's the two-on-one. Quine's got his head up. Luongo's in a pretty good position. Looks like he was looking high all the way. Luongo just gets the top of his glove on it. Cal Clutterbuck. It looks to me like someone's called timeout, and I gotta believe that's the Islanders, because Tavares is exhausted. With just 2 minutes to go, you might as well use it now, Howie.
Huberdeau working it back towards Petrovic. Picked off by Nelson. But now Huberdeau right back into the Islander zone. Huberdeau, quick shot, save Greiss. And a good one on Huberdeau.
Greiss continues to maintain his focus. Boy, you got to be strong mentally to be able to do that for as long as he has been doing it in this game here, with the intensity involved, the pressure involved.
It's an intro check on the faceoff. Pushed along to Kuhlman, and he lugs it out of there. Looks for Nielsen, hits him on the move, in over the line, feeds Letty, he shoots off the glove and in back to the pocket of the mitt of Luongo, and he'll hold on. Looked like he made the save, and then the puck started to roll on him, but he was able to regain control, and a face-off in the Florida zone.
Well, that was right off the face-off, and Kuhlman gets the feet moving right away. Stops, waits for Franz Nielsen, a little backhand flip, and there's a good opportunity, and what a save by Luongo as he splashes the trapper. That's a good opportunity, and you're right, Howie, got him on the inside of the big trapper, but he makes the save.
Remaining in the first overtime. Hamannik trying to chop it up the boards, didn't clear. Barkov kept it in. Now for Purcell, out to the blue line. Ekblad, a shot, it's stopped by Greiss. Well, the clock ran down, and I looked up. There are, I think, 6/10 of a second left, and they're going to put a little time on here.
To hear on you. Let's just take a little look how much this referee's got to run. Yeah, might be a minute now.
I saw 1-8 when that. Off the draw, they wrestle, and it rolls past Smith. And for the second straight game, there will be a second overtime period. The Islanders outshot the Panthers 15-8. In the first overtime, and a lot of that in the first 10 or 12 minutes. Panthers came on a little bit later. For the game, the shots are 47-38, Islanders, and it is the first time in franchise history that they've played consecutive multiple overtime games. Now, game five went 16 minutes exactly into the second overtime before Quine won it. Who wins it tonight? We'll find out eventually. And who's felt the brunt of it tonight? Once again, the usual suspects.
Yeah, it's the five guys you would think would be the most, have the most ice time. And you just got to wonder, can they dig down and find a way to continue to play hard? And for the Florida Panthers, much the same group. Brian Campbell playing a little bit more than he's had over the last couple of games. But look at Gabranson, hard minutes. Barkov played the most, the big centerman. Well, he's a young guy, but the thing that's now that's most important, Howie, is, you know, monitoring your shifts. Well, like I said earlier on, you know, go 30 seconds and try and make the smart change, chip it in when you have to.
So here goes Nielsen, Bernier, Kuhlman for the Islanders, Barkov, Huberdeau, Yager for Florida. Smith and Letty going after it behind the net. Jokinen looks for Trocheck. Tavares got back, recovered by Smith, and that one hit the crossbar. And carries out of play.
Well, you know, the Florida Panthers, they don't have a lot of gas in the tank, and after about the first 10 minutes last overtime, they came to a complete standstill, so you know there's going to be a big push. Travis Hamonic tried to poke check and missed it, and that allowed Trocheck to get the shot away, and Thomas Greiss didn't have his usual position either. He was caught in the net a little bit. So there's going to be a tremendous push by the Panthers for these first couple of shifts to try and end it.
They have owned the first minute and 32 of the second overtime. It goes wide. Greiss took a little contact there, I believe, with Trocheck, but here's Cizikas moving well. In over the line. Now to Prince. Quick shot juggled by Luongo. Sits to the right of the net and then rolls to the corner. Comes back out in front. Loose puck. They bat away at it. But Hudler exchanged to Gudbranson. Batted away. Islanders look to attack. Nelson will have to go to the bench as he's out of gas. And gas is at a premium now. 7 minutes into the second overtime.
Running on empty, most of these guys.
Martin, he's by himself. He needs that dump in. Does that. Now waiting for a change. Close into Campbell.
The fans are they're on the edge of their seats, and there's so much push from both of these guys. They're having to dig down so hard to get yourself up the ice, and then if there's any kind of a turnover, now you got to find the legs to go back, and that's a near impossible task. So you're trying to balance the act of, you know, playing it safe, yet trying to figure out how to get an opportunity, and that's a tough one.
Nassau Coliseum never saw a game as long as this one. Three longer games in Islanders history have all been played on the road. And Jedlicki in a tussle here with Shaw. Good positional work there by Jedlicki.
Good legs for Jedlicki.
Tavares, the right wing, too far for Jedlicki. Batted back the other way, but sent in for Oposo with Tavares. Feeds Tavares. Quick shot saved, made by the pad of Luongo. Tavares scores! Tavares wins it on a backhander. It's over. It is all over. For the first time in 23 years, the New York Islanders have won a playoff round. And perhaps the most fitting man to score the winner is John Tavares.
Was a spectacular play, Howie. The puck got up, and with Kyle Oposo giving it to Tavares, Tavares is able to get the shot on net, but there was a rebound, and he just was on it so fast, and he knew right away it was going to be the wraparound. He knew Luongo was out of position, and that's just a very big move from an elite hockey player. No second chances there, and the fans. Unbelievable. What a series. Islanders, Florida Panthers, it just doesn't get any better than that. You talk about two teams that went at it tooth and nail, gave it their all, Howie. Florida Panthers were a worthy opponent. I mean, it was spectacular.
This is a first step that so many people in this organization have worked for so long to make into reality. And it's, on one hand, only one round. But at the same time, it feels like the Islanders, the players, the coaches, the management, the ownership, they can kind of throw that anvil off their back as they no longer have to hear about how many years it's been since they won a playoff round. Now they think about the next round against the Tampa Bay Lightning. Thomas Greiss, who was the backup goaltender, and there was so much question when Yaroslav Halak went down. Could Greiss handle the load? Boy, did he handle the load in this series.
He gave them everything they could hope for, and just a little bit more. Howie, at the end of the day, Luongo was very, very good. Spectacular series for Luongo, but Thomas Greiss was just one goal better. He was unbelievable. What an effort for the Islanders. And you had the sense, Howie, that it was their time. You know, with the late goal by Tavares to send it into overtime, those are signs that, okay, something good's going to happen, and it took them a little while. And listen to these fans. You mentioned it. They've been waiting a long, long time. And this is a happy bunch of guys because they talked about it. They lamented about that Game 7 loss to the Capitals last year. I asked them several different times, and they were unhappy with themselves. They wanted a chance to with a reprieve, and boy, did they ever.
Well, it's quite an experience, and one that a lot of these fans had never felt, to see the Islanders clinch a playoff series at home. A best of seven series, that is. The last time a series of this length was won by the Islanders on their own ice was the first cup winner. But what an amazing second effort by John Tavares. And we all, you know, we pump a guy's tires that don't need to be pumped in John Tavares, but that was a transcendent play by a transcendent player who's found even another gear in this series.
Well, the playoffs for John Tavares has been unbelievable.
Well, Tavares is ready to talk about it downstairs with Shannon. Enjoy.
John, I just want to know, how does all of this feel right now?
It's hard to take in. It was an incredible series. You know, kudos to Florida, man. Those games were tough. Obviously, tonight we wanted to get it done and at home and finally get a series win and then to move on. We're excited. Everyone tonight, incredible, just incredible.
What did it take from your team to get to this point? The overtime, the work that went into it. How proud are you of your team right now?
Well, you know, we didn't have our best really all series, and you know, but we fought hard. We gave ourselves a chance. Thomas was incredible. Everyone just kept sticking with it, and we just right to the end find a way, and nice to get it.
You mentioned Thomas, right? This is the guy that started out as your backup. How important has he been for this series, and will he continue to be as you now look forward to facing the Tampa Bay Lightning?
I mean, he's been unbelievable. All year, really, the first half of the season, he really kept us in games, and we got our game going a little bit, and no question, the series at crucial times, he was huge.
John, go celebrate this win with your team. Thanks so much for your time.
Thank you.
Guys, back up to you.
Shannon, thanks. I'm not sure we're even ready to speak yet because the experience of the emotion and relief, to be sure, as well, has people just as speechless as they are exultant. That'll go down as one of the more famous overtime goals in Islander history. Post game next. Butch Goring, Shannon Hogan, Stan Fischler, Rick DiPietro, Bob Nystrom, Ken Morrow, and Islander heroes past are joined by John Tavares on the Mercedes-Benz Islanders postgame. One of those moments that if you don't go back to the Cup years and you don't even remember David Volek, moment that you'll savor and treasure for a long time. The scary thing about it is, it's only the first round. You've got to win four of these things to win the Stanley Cup, and yet you did it four times. How is it even possible?
Well, it is possible, but it's plays like that that get you to the next level. And you know, if you've never seen a hockey game and this was your first one, how do you not become an instant fan, Howie? Because this is what hockey is all about. I mean, to get into these situations, to feel the pressure, to feel the intensity, and then to see the big moment. And a star like John Tavares, and you said it appropriately, if there was anybody who was going to do it, it was going to be John Tavares. Ties the game up late, sends it into overtime, and then makes a spectacular move on Luongo, first to get that opening shot, and then the wraparound stayed right with it. I mean, it's just so doggone exciting, Howie. I mean, I was up out of my seat as I saw him come close to scoring, because I knew what he was doing right away. He knew what he was doing right away. And there's just very few guys that can do that. And you can see the excitement of the Islander players. But more importantly, is they got the monkey off the back, Howie. They're taking the next step.
There's almost no words necessary to punctuate it, but you'll see the image time after time after time in your own mind, if it means that much to you as a fan. And certainly in the dossier of John Tavares, it'll be one that is replayed for years and years as his career evolves. But You know, the thing about Tavares, don't forget, he got the first one, too, that got it to overtime.
Yeah, exactly. And you think those coaches are happy? They're hugging one another. And, you know, that's what playoff hockey does to you, though. It raises the emotions, and they're uncontrollable at times, and guys can make mistakes. But certainly, you know what, it makes it so much fun when you're on the proper end of it. And before we go on, kudos to the Florida Panthers for having a marvelous season, winning their divisions, and then they played spectacular, and you know, it's tough losers, but that's what playoff hockey is all about, is that, you know, people play so well, they commit so long to try and get into a situation to take the next step, and it's a learning curve, and Florida Panthers will be more difficult next year.
The Islanders scored 15 goals in this series. Four of them were scored by John Tavares. He had five assists, so he was in on the scoring for nine of the 15 goals, and that's what you look for. When you've got a team that's that hasn't won anything really, and needs to be carried past a very difficult opponent as the Florida Panthers were, well, you lean on your best players, and John was every bit that.
Yeah, and you know what? They're across the Canada, across the United States, those have heard about John Tavares. They know that he's a good player, but anybody watched him in this playoff series, that's a different player. There's a new elevation to his game. I have never seen him play with as much dedication, with as much purpose at any time during his career, Howie. He just took it to another level, and as many people were saying, this guy was going to will his team into the next round of the playoffs, and he may not have quite done that, but he certainly went a long ways to making sure that they got into the next round.
And if John Tavares was the obvious candidate to lead the Islanders to a playoff series win, the goaltender, you always focus on the goaltender and say he's a necessary candidate. But Thomas Grice was a guy that we knew so little about in terms of his ability to play at a high level in games like this. And boy, Grice, you know, he may have become the Islanders' number one goaltender beyond this year, however it turns out.
He certainly turned a lot of heads, Howie, and you're right, there was question marks, because if you haven't been there before, how do you know how anybody's going to perform? But Thomas Grice, if there was critics up there, he shut him up rather quickly, because he was unbelievable, game in and game out. And I don't think he let a bad goal in this six-game series, and I know one thing for certain is that he made a lot of big, big saves at some timely moments. So the Islanders have got themselves a terrific goaltender. If Halak gets back into the fray, Coach Capuano will maybe have some decisions at some point in time. But for now, Thomas Grice is the man.
The man in goal, and the man who scored the goal, John Tavares, the stars of the show tonight. As the Islanders advance, they will play the Tampa Bay Lightning in the next round of the Stanley Cup playoff series. Two former Islander first-round picks. Welcome back to the Mercedes-Benz Islanders postgame show in the aftermath of a series clinching goal by John Tavares, which has sent over 15,000 people into absolute pandemonium here in Brooklyn. And who knows how many others watching at home or listening in their cars or however they might have absorbed it. Now, yes, 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 it's supposed to be a three-word cadence. It was one string of about 50 consecutive yeses after John Tavares became our Cadillac Key performer tonight by moving the Islanders into the next round. How about Alan Quine on that line? He scores the game winner in double overtime in game five to put the Islanders up. And then he almost gets the game winner in overtime in the first overtime period. But in the end, that's a mere footnote. Tavares, our Cadillac Key performer, did your key performer match up to who we picked? Tweet in if you agree or disagree with us at hashtag Cadillac KP. And you can look at the numbers and say, okay, yeah, that's interesting, and maybe there's an edge there. But the bottom line is, doesn't mean a thing. The only numbers that matter now, Islanders 2, Panthers 1, Islanders 4, Panthers 2 in games. And now it'll be the Islanders and the Tampa Bay Lightning. They are two of the longest tenured Islanders to whom this means so much, Franz Nielsen and Kyle Okposo, both of whom are unrestricted free agents after the year. And they might have been sold on staying a little bit with this celebration. We'll be back with more in a moment.
It was a magical night in Brooklyn. Islanders beating the Florida Panthers in game six, and they are going to the second round of the playoffs for the first time in 23 years. It was an exciting series. We're thrilled to see where they're going to go as the playoff run continues. Throughout the Islanders' playoff run, MSG Plus will have complete post-game coverage after every single playoff game. You're not going to want to miss it. And for more post-game coverage, you can always go to MSGNetworks.com. Coming up next on MSG Plus, it is a replay of Game 6 on Islanders Playoff Rewind. John Tavares was absolutely fantastic. Thomas Greif stood on his head. And for all of us on our MSG Plus broadcast, Howie, Butch, Dan, Rick, all the guys in the truck, thank you so much for watching. Also, we want to give our best to our audio engineer, Basil Medichek, who is retiring after several years with us here on MSG Plus. We'll see you guys in Tampa.